Mozambique as a surfing culture is growing, but there's a lot that Mozambique had to do to build up to where it is now. There's so much more potential in Mozambique, and so now that the Mozambicans are leading the charge, I think a lot of the world will start to see what we have to offer.
Africa's longest conflicts came to an abrupt end in Mozambique. Soon after, small bands of surfers started to explore the tropical frontier that had been off limits for decades. But finding paradise never comes easy.
When I came here, in 88, you couldn't travel out of Maputo. There was only one road in and out, and there were like fucking trucks burning on those roads in those days. And you had no idea who's a soldier, and everybody was under the same oppression. Soldiers, bandits, you got no idea who is who. It was a destabilization of the country. People had no money, but they looked after us, where they shared the best food that they had with total strangers. That's the thing that blew me away about Mozambique more than anything. End of 92, I was on Inyaka, they declared peace. So bang, like that, in one day, suddenly there's peace. Now you can drive anywhere you want to do, you can do anything you want now. So, okay, let's go and explore. I don't think any of the waves that I surfed had ever been surfed before. Frankie would have come while I was there on Inyaka, but I never surfed that wave because I had no access to it.
We just heard there's waves in Mozambique, so we went for a look. That's what we used to do on the search. You just go, bro, and we were just looking for surf, and we hit a luck. We ended up getting a yacht from Richards Bay, but the night we wanted to leave was that big cyclone, giant surf. So we left at 1 in the morning, and then I woke up. There was waves coming through my cabin, I guess. Out. I look that side, I just check waves going through their cabin. Everyone's puking, as they're holding on railings. I thought we were gonna die. So that's it, boys. We're going down. Everyone's hanging on the railings. We're just dying. Got through the night, some miracle. Next day, same thing. It's just up and down. No one said one word. We're still in the same spot because there's a cyclone easterly, so we couldn't get past. And then eventually the westy came. Turn. And then we started going forward. Then we're sailing down. Big swells. And then that's how we found Inyaka. We're just cruising to the first bay that went in. It looked like a long reef, so we thought, hey, that looks like a good wave. So we just went into the bay there, slept for the night, and then the wind turned around offshore the next day. And then we came around the corner the next day, I was cooking. Best waves ever seen. Like solid 6 to 8 foot, double up, blow out, pitch brilliant. Cooking. Yeah, so yeah, we didn't expect anything. We just went for a look.
A few years later, a speciality surf contest was held at Ponta da Hora, just beyond the South African border, and proved beyond a doubt that Mozambique was holding world-class waves. Despite these early glimpses of perfection, the flow of surfers to post-war Mozambique remained a slow trickle.
The whole of Mozambique was just landmines everywhere, bro. So they had to clear that whole area first. Ponta was landmines full up, bro. Like if you went off the pathway a little bit, you'd blown up, bro. But now it's like another world now. But the thing is, it's very fickle, eh? A lot of east wind howling, like days and days, and it's flat, and it's just windy and hot. But when you hear this Madagascan cyclone, then you know you're gonna get it. Bink's the man for that. He's pretty sharp. He's always on it when it's up there.
I started hearing about waves in Mozambique was, you know, that first gotcha experience. A little bit before that, I did a trip up to a place called Shai Shai, and then from there it was like, all right, what's next? The roads were ridiculous, just mud tracks to the biggest pothole you can ever imagine, and you never drive straight on a road. You were doing this. You were zigzagging the whole way to Mozambique on one frickin' road. That was an absolute nightmare. But yeah, skunked a couple times. Hey, but you had it as well. Proper. From there on, it's become an addiction where it can be awesome and it can be the most fickle place ever. I think that's what captured me, eh? Just the potential of that really, really good day. It's trial and error. That's where the hard work comes in. Hold your breath, boys. It's not about the surf. That's just hard. Mozambique has grown. Surfing has grown. There was like a small surfing culture, but in the last 7 or 8 years, it's really taken off.
My name is Sang Min Cho, but I'm locally known as Mini Cho, and I'm from Tofu, Mozambique. I am the first and currently the only Mozambican professional surfer that's representing Mozambique. I only started surfing when I was 14. I used to hang on the beach with my brothers, play football, and I always used to watch the surfers and always wanted to surf, but my parents couldn't afford for us to learn how to surf to get the equipment. And then one day somebody gave me a surfboard and that's how it started. I had no coaching, no guidance. I kind of learned for myself. I was surfing the bay. It's a very soft, mushy wave. And then one day there was a really good shore break and I took off and it was a closeout shore break, probably like half a second, but I got that first vision of a barrel and that's what pushed me to surf. I was so consumed by it. I just did it every day, every hour, whenever I could. At the time when I was learning how to surf, they were the first core group of Mozambican surfers, but they're a very small group, and the level of surfing was still pretty low. You know, they weren't pushing to be professional or anything, so it was hard to look within the surf community for inspiration and to be pushed, and so I always had to look outside. Jordy comes here a lot, and I drew inspiration from Jordy surfing because he's so powerful. He makes surfing just look beautiful.
First time I went to Mozambique was around 2006 or 2007. I did a trip with Surfer Mag and myself, Travis Logie, Royden Bryson, and Ricky Basnett. Drove across the border, we went to Ponto, and we scored some really fun waves. And then around 2011 or 12, I started venturing a little further, and basically how it came about was my wife Lyndall, her and her family growing up were really, really big campers and really into going to the bush and kind of discovering new places. And she would always say to me, "Oh babe, you know, I think there's these waves down there, you know, we should take a trip there sometime and go check it out and you can surf." And I was always like, yeah, you know, I'm sure there's waves, it's probably like some pussy little longboard thing. And I'd heard of guys kind of going there and trying to get waves, but never really scoring great stuff. But one year we decided, okay, let's go for a trip. Let's go down there. Ryan Rubnick had actually driven up from Durban to help us. And sure enough, showed up to some of these waves. And it was just like this out of body experience. I remember coming over the dune, we drove over the dune, and I just started absolutely freaking out.
Woohoo! Okay, we gotta go.
How
do we
turn to be
that way.
Get these boards off.
That was the first time I'd ever seen African Kira. When I first started going to Mozambique, there weren't too many Mozambican surfers, and they haven't had the best facilities, and it wasn't exactly on a silver platter for them to be able to perform and really get better. And so in the short space of time that they've had, they've really excelled.
Boy just got such a nice nag.
As far as the local scene goes, it's really grown. especially throughout the last 10 years, and especially in Tofino. There's a lot of talent starting to kind of come out of that area.
Começamos a surfar exatamente em 2012, mas não foi fácil porque nós nem sabíamos nadar, então tivemos que falar com um dos pescadores que sabia um pouco de nadar e parecer que foi fácil, mas não foi fácil. Isto porque para nadar nós usávamos os poucos para amarrar aqui nos ombros, na cintura, assim como nos pés. Então a gente ficava somente a flutuar em cima, aquilo de fazer e assim mesmo aprendemos pouco a pouco a nadar. Então a partir daí é onde nós vimos o professor que nos deu aulas de surfar e então ele abriu as portas. Me lembro que começamos a surfar, éramos seis jovens, mas é que vieram mais jovens da então, e assim começamos a surfar desde lá até agora, epa, uma maravilha.
Benny is now the guy that a lot of the young kids look up to. He's got a really positive outlook on life, a definite hard-working mentality, and there's no better breeding ground, I don't think.
For me, I didn't want to be the first and only. I wanted to be the first of many. And so that's why I started the Tofu Surf Club to grow surfing. I want to see Mozambique on the world stage, you know, representing on the ISA World Games, the Olympics. And I want to see many more Mozambican kids surfing. I don't want to be the only one. This is the Tofu Surf Club. The club basically is a diversion program, and what we're really, really trying to do is it's a way to keep kids engaged in the ocean life, but also keep kids in school. You don't have to pay anything. Basically, all they have to do is just go to school. And if kids can't do that, we try and help them. The club will try and pay for the kids' school fees, bags, uniforms. So we want to keep kids in school, educate them, teach them about more of their own self-worth, self-value, and for them to realize their full potential. So the club, surfing, and keeping them in school all works together here. On a day-to-day basis, what we do is the kids come in at around 2 o'clock, and then at around 2:30, we start our nutritional program. So we have a nutritional program where we feed the kids a nice fresh fruit smoothie every day, just to kind of give them that energy. It's very hot here in Mozambique. And then we get the kids all ready to go down to the beach, so you can see they get all their boards, and then we line up in the front and we go down to the beach. Amazing to see kids from all different types of backgrounds, different religions and different ethnicities, and also lots of female surfing. We have surfers like Julia. Julia is the first female surfer, and she's a big inspiration to a lot of kids. Sometimes Julia will catch a wave and she'll ask if we saw the wave, and we'll be like, no, but we heard it, because she always goes down the wave hooting and screaming, going way down the point. So that's our joke. We're always like, no, we didn't see a wave, but we heard it.
Eu sou Julia. Eu sou moçambicana. Eu surfo aqui em Tofo. Eu vejo as mulheres aqui, tipo, a sair em um grupo grande. E o mundo vai ser nice, o mundo vai ser mais feliz, porque o surf é uma coisa que deixa todo mundo feliz.
Here in Tofu, you can see the communities rising up, realizing their self-worth and their place in Mozambique. But there's a lot that Mozambique had to do to build up to where it is now. Whenever you surf the point, you can actually see the monument. It was put there to represent the fight for independence, and it's such an iconic sign of power and strength. There's so much more potential in Mozambique, and so now that the Mozambicans are leading the charge, I think a lot of the world will start to see what we have to offer.
Got some swell, and we've got a neap tide, which is actually good because if it was springs, we wouldn't be able to cross. But yeah, got some definitely the swell pushing the water in, eh? More than actually the tide, which is a great sign, definitely.
A few years after surfing Namibia at Skeleton Bay, we started to hear about a right-hand version on the east coast of Africa, but it would only work on very, very specific cyclones, specific directions, and guys would go there often in the early years and not get anything, and it became this kind of unicorn. Everyone thought it was just, you know, an empty flat sandbar. Eventually, Jordy and a crew got it on a couple of really good swells, and they named it the African Kira.
And it kind of set the benchmark for what's still out there in Mozambique.
But even if a cyclone comes into the channel, you never know what you're going to get there until you actually get to the beach.
Wow.
That's pretty amazing. Yeah. Flying, eh? And the bottom section.
That one, it just kept going and going and going. Damn, your gut wants you to stall for the barrel, but you kind of just gotta pump. It's actually what I was telling Mikey and Saxton. When you take off on a wave, just pump it and then it'll start giving. Local knowledge.
Next level heavier.
As soon as you're pretty much in the barrel, you're just like doing these pumps because it just goes. As soon as it hits that bag, the bottom bag especially just goes.
so steep and then trying to pull out, getting sucked over. Once you're in, then you're good to go.
It's a different concept when you're out there to when you're watching it on the beach. It's so fast that it's actually over quite quickly. But the distance you've traveled is super amazing. It changes a lot through the day. But there's always going to be someone that gets that gem. It just depends on who gets it.
But I don't know, every now and again like a bigger one comes and really like, I don't know, runs along the bank really nicely, but it's an incredible wave. It's nice to surf a right like this. Yeah.
This place, this little tiny bit of peninsula is magical, but I think there's so much more potential in Mozambique. And so I think now that the Mozambicans are leading the charge for surf tourism, surf exploration, the future of Mozambican surfing is looking great.
Nothing. think I wanted to share the waves. Big mistake. We all think we're doing the right thing. At the end of the day, you're going to regret it.
I don't think we've seen it at its full potential yet. And hopefully one day we'll get it as good as it can be.
Country's got a lot to offer, eh? The people are amazing. And there are more waves there.
The rest of Mozambique's just huge question marks on what else is out there.
That was the one, bro.
As he bottom turned, the thing already spat. Pulled in for about 5 seconds, 6 seconds. Thing spat. Then he came out slowly. He invited in again, another 5, 6 seconds. Again, came out just his nose like a, it was like a TV game. It was 4 or 5 barrels you got in a row, but they were all 10 pointers. You got like a 50 point wave, bro.